Hey, so I guess to kind of set the table for the text this morning, we're going to look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 1 through 11. And to set the table and kind of get our bearings, I want to just back us up a little bit because I love this section in Philippians. Kind of from the end of chapter 1 through chapter 2 into chapter 3, Paul is talking to this church about their citizenship in heaven. And so I want to set the table a little bit. Now in our house, we get one of the kids to set the table. That's how it works. When it's mealtime, it's like mom says or dad calls downstairs, hey, come set the table. And usually there's squawking involved in that. I don't know if your house is like that. It's like, I set the table yesterday. But you're coming to set the table again today. And so we're going to set the table with Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. It's going to come up on the screen, but it says this. I'll read it to you, okay? Only let the manner of your life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. So whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear that you are standing firm in one spirit with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. So let me give you a quick synopsis really of chapter or this verse here through to chapter 2, because I think it will help us with the thread of where I think the Spirit's leading us this morning to just chat. Paul had been calling this church to live as though they had been colonized by the kingdom of heaven. Philippi is an interesting city. Philippi was a Greek city, but Philippi was totally colonized as a Roman city. They had all the rights of citizenship of Rome. And so Paul is playing on this idea with this church as he calls them citizens of heaven. And so he says, I want you to live a life worthy of the gospel, to strive side by side with one another. I want you to live as though you've been colonized by the kingdom of heaven, you're citizens of heaven, and just like you would be loyal to Rome, and you would receive the benefits of your Roman citizenship, so too as followers of Jesus, live a life that is worthy of the gospel. And so he says part of that is this, you got to stand firm. You got to be side by side in your striving in the kingdom. In fact, where he goes at the end of chapter 1 is he says this, he says, in the face of opposition, you stand together. In spite of suffering, you stand together. In the potential of conflict or trouble, you stand together because as followers of Jesus, in your loyalty to the gospel, that's how you live as citizens of heaven. And then he takes us to this famous text in chapter 2, following the example of Christ, this loyal citizens of heaven, we're to imitate the character of our leader. We're to emulate the nature and the character of King Jesus. We're to have the mind of Christ. Now, when I think about that, to me, that is incredibly demanding to tell me, imitate Jesus. Be like Jesus. Oh, is that all? That's it? Oh, okay, I just got to be like Jesus. No problem. It's a tough task what Paul's calling us to. It's a high calling. And when I think about this life of faith and telling me to simply be like Jesus, well, to me that's unattainable. Until we see what Paul says is this, is that it's not pressure from without, but that there's a power of the Spirit from within for the follower of Christ that enables us to imitate Jesus. He actually says this, it's a passage that you'll know well there, verse 12 and 13 of chapter 2, he says this, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Work out what the Spirit of God has worked into you. So he's saying this, and we're going to see this as we get into chapter 3, that what happens is needs to be from the inside. It's a work of the Spirit rather than outward conformity and pressure. We're to work out what God has worked in. And so we work that out from this inner power of the Spirit. And then Paul says this, he calls them to be lights of the world. And he gives three practical ways on how you can work out your faith. He says, shine for Jesus, speak for Jesus, and sacrifice for the kingdom. Sacrifice. And then the chapter 2 ends with two examples. Paul gives the example of Timothy. He doesn't point to himself. He says, look at Timothy. Timothy is a guy who is like this. He emulates Jesus. He shines for the kingdom. He speaks for King Jesus. He's sacrificing for the kingdom. He points to this man, Epaphroditus. And so what Paul does is he takes this demanding, hard concept of imitating and emulating and modeling the nature of King Jesus, and he makes it really practical and really tangible and takes this difficult instruction, brings it down to earth so that we can work out what God has worked in, what the Holy Spirit has worked in. Shine and speak and sacrifice for Jesus. And really, just for me as I've been wrestling with this text, the thing that jumped out to me is this is, and we're going to see here in a second, that the key to joy in the Christian life is to sacrifice for the kingdom of God. That sacrifice for the kingdom leads to the Holy Spirit opening up the fountain of his joy in your life. And so if you were to do a personal assessment this morning, this afternoon, I keep saying this morning because, you know, who has church at 2:30 in the afternoon? Actually, I like it. You know, staying with Cain and Alva. I had like ham and eggs and this big breakfast. Usually I'm like out the door in the morning. You guys get this cool brunch thing going on. Great host, by the way, Cain and Alva. And so a healthy question for us is this question. What am I sacrificing for the kingdom of God? What sacrifice is there in my life for the kingdom of God? And if there is joy missing in your life, if there is joy missing in your walk with Jesus, it's pointing to this fact in your life. That there is some level of sacrifice that's not happening. And so, naturally, Paul talks about Timothy, he talks about Epaphroditus, and he circles the wagon back, and he comes to this topic of joy. That's why I wanted us to get context here. As we come to chapter 3, circles back the wagon, he touches down once again on this call to joy, this call to rejoice. And Paul is going to give us three duties that we are called to, three responsibilities, three obligations that are ours as those who have been colonized by heaven, those who are citizens of the kingdom of heaven. They're up on the screen. And so let's take a peek, and we're going to read the first three verses here of Philippians chapter 3, 1 through 3. It says this. I'm reading from the ESV. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write these same things to you is no trouble to me, and it is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit and who glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. And so just a quick, simple outline up on your screen. We're to rejoice in the Lord, verse 1. We're to be aware of some dangers, verse 2. And we are to know the true marks of a citizen of heaven. So let's talk about those a little bit. Now, it's no wonder, I guess I would say, that Paul would write that it's no trouble for me, it's no skin off my back to tell you to rejoice because it's safe. It's safe for me to tell you to rejoice because the truth is that rejoicing doesn't always come natural. You know what comes natural for me? Murmuring, complaining, silent mumbles that no one else hears, you know, those attitudes and judgments that come out of me, and I can share those because I know you're the same, you know? And then sometimes they actually surface and you vocalize them and you complain out loud or fault find. Or, you know, maybe even seek to elicit sympathy in some sort of self-glorifying way. It's easy. That stuff comes natural. And so rejoicing is not always natural. And Paul says, it's no trouble for me to tell you this. So let me ask you a question. Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. But have you ever been arrested? Dale, I said, don't raise your hand. No, he didn't raise his hand. I'm just kidding. Have you ever been arrested? Now, hopefully not. But the truth is, in a room this size, you know, statistics, there's probably some people in here. You know, you might want to give an eye to that person sitting next to you. And husbands, if that's your wife, be careful. Days early, she could be arrested yet. You could be harmed, and I don't want that to happen. No, so but all, you know, joking, I ask that. Have you ever been arrested? But this is a pretty sweet part of following Jesus. So check this out. As citizens of heaven, you've been given all authority to make arrests. To make arrests, like a citizen's arrest. It comes with the rights of citizenship in the kingdom of heaven. And here's what you're to arrest. This is what you are to handcuff. This is what you are to lock up in your life. You are to handcuff the tendency to murmur. You are to handcuff the tendency to complain. You need to take those things prisoner. Anything that would hinder the command to rejoice in the Lord, you should arrest in your life. Because rejoicing in the Lord is both a duty and a privilege of citizenship. So I'd say this, resist the temptation to despair. Resist the temptation to depression. Resist the temptation to being melancholy. Resist those things. Resist the temptation to complain, just like you would resist any form of sin. In fact, Romans chapter 14, verse 23 says this, whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. And I know in my life, any murmuring, complaining, melancholy, that stuff is never rooted in faith for me. And so we're to rejoice in the Lord, and part of maturing is learning to arrest anything that steals your joy. And you know those attitudes in your own life that can do that. Sometimes the ability to make the rest is quick. It's like really easy to identify the source. It's really easy to identify the enemy. And the rest is quick. Other times, the thief is hard to capture, hard to identify. And so because he's hard to identify, he's not quick to arrest. And so you struggle sometimes in detaining the culprit that's robbing you of your joy. Sometimes it's a manhunt. Sometimes it takes a serious investigation. Sometimes you have to call on the hound of heaven. Say, Spirit of God, I need you to search me and see what's going on. Reveal, bring it to the surface, Lord, whatever's robbing me of joy so that I can rejoice in you. You know, just in my own life recently, I was dealing with a situation. It wasn't in our church. It was like a personal situation for me outside of the life of everything. And just in this conflict that went kind of sideways, I was so angry. So angry with this person. And I'm like, this is ridiculous. This doesn't even have whatever arguments are going on in my head, they don't make sense. They're not real. Spirit of God, I need you to work in me in this and change my character and help me, because I'm not in my rational right mind like a lot of times. And so this is very practical for us. As Paul simply says this, the first obligation of heavenly citizenship is this. Rejoice in the Lord. The second is this. He says you need to be aware of some dangers. The citizens of heaven. So he says, look out, verse 2, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. Now, first one, look out for the dogs. Now, have you ever been chased by a dog? I've been chased by a dog. Anybody got one of those stories? Lots of us have those stories from our childhood. You know, some point, somewhere, sometime, you had a run-in with a dog. Mine happened on King Road. And I grew up in Gibson's. It happened on King Road. It's this long, dirt, straight country road with no houses and lots of forest. And I was about 10, and I had this super cool bike. I had a full suspension bike when I was 10 years old. And it was the classic, not like the new style full suspension bikes. Mine had a plastic gas tank on the front with a number. You remember those ones? Big banana seat, weighed about 65 pounds, looked like a motocross bike, like totally cool. I had one of those things. And after I outgrew that bike, I ordered my first mountain bike from the Sears catalog. Remember those? That was real life in Canada. Anyways, I had this super cool motocross pedal bike, and on this particular day, I wasn't riding that bike. I was riding my mom's 10-speed, which is not cool either. And so, you know, I'm riding up King Road, I'm in this area, and in this area was this kind of notorious house where there was a pit bull at the front door and there was a pit bull at the back door, and you knew to stay away from this place as a kid. And so I was on the other side of the street, avoiding this house, riding up the street. The house was to my left, and to my right, I didn't see the pit bull was actually in the ditch right there. And I came riding up the street, and this dog saw me, and he came at me. And I began pedaling, and he was gaining on me and gaining, and then he lunged at my right leg, and I lifted up my leg like this as I'm pedaling, and the dog missed. And kind of with that lunge, he lost his momentum, and my mom's 10 speed never went so fast ever, and I got out of there. Now Paul says this. He says you have to look out for the dogs. They come when you're not suspecting them sometimes. You know, in the mind of an ancient Jew, that reference to the dog is not a cute lap dog like the one that I, little Molly at Cain and Alva's house. It's not like that. It's a reference to a mangy street mutt that is a garbage eating and a pack hunting dog that's an unclean animal. Look out for the dogs. In the mind of the ancient Greek, the reference was this. It was like the ferocity of an untamed animal that's greedy. Beware the dog. Went for a walk this morning. Went to Nose Hill. It was really nice. You guys do that regular? That's a nice viewpoint. So I went up Nose Hill, and then I was making my way back for breakfast, and I saw the sign on a gate. Beware the dog. You know that song, that sign. Look out for the dogs. And so the warning is this. Look out. Beware of those who are quarrelsome. Beware of those who have a contentious spirit. Look out for those who, under the guise of religion, are unclean or impure, who themselves are not only defiled, but they want to defile others with the influence of their bite. Look out for those who bite. Look out for the dogs. Look out for those who snap at your heels with that rabid and infectious bite, the rabid and infectious bite of the false teacher. Those who are quarrelsome and contentious. He says, look, then he says this, look out for the evildoer. Look out for the evildoers. Some translations say evil workers rather than evildoers. These evil workers are those that who teach that we are saved and our salvation is faith plus some good work. It's Jesus plus. And in particular, works of the law. And see, the problem with them and that teaching is that those works that are Jesus plus, the things that we add to Jesus are works of the flesh. They're not the working out of what God has worked in. They're an outward conformity, pressure to outward conformity, not performed by the Spirit, but performed by the flesh. And in the end, those works don't bring glory to Jesus, but they bring glory to the one who performed them. You know, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, familiar verse, it's on the screen. It says this, for it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. No one's saved by good works, we know that. Even religious works. For a follower of Jesus, good works are the fruit of faith, not the root of faith, not the basis of salvation, but the fruit of salvation. And so Paul says, look out for that. You've got to watch for it as a citizen. Then he says this, look out for those who mutilate the flesh. And Paul's ministry was dogged by these guys. We call them Judaizers. They didn't deny that Jesus was their Messiah or that his gospel was the power of God for salvation for all who would believe. But what they insisted was this, that any Gentile who came to faith in Jesus could not really come into or experience the fullness of the gospel and its power unless they came through the law of Moses. And so their assertion was this, that a Gentile could not be saved unless they had been circumcised according to the tradition of the law. They taught this is necessary for salvation. And so when Paul calls them a mutilator of the flesh, he's referring to circumcision. He's being sarcastic. It's a sarcastic way of talking about the religious rite and practice of circumcision. And the true follower, the true member of the kingdom, the true Christian experience is a spiritual circumcision in Christ. It does not require fleshly operation. It's a work of the Spirit. And so what these teachers were doing was this, is that they were taking a work of the Spirit and they were adding and demanding that a work of the flesh be added to it. And they taught that a work of the flesh, a physical operation, was necessary for true salvation. We know this. Only Jesus can save. Faith in Christ Jesus accomplishes what a physical operation can, a new heart. God's Spirit put within us. And so he says, look out for those who mutilate the flesh. Now, it's, to contrast the false now, what Paul begins to do is describe for us a genuine follower of Jesus. And he calls them the true circumcision. Look at verse 3. For we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. So this is the third obligation of heavenly citizenship, and it's this: we're to know the true marks of a citizen. And we know how to identify Canadians, right? We have citizenship. We need to know how to identify those who, we need to be able to self-diagnose. What are the marks of citizenship? And so firstly, he says this, it's this: you worship by the Spirit of God. That phrase can be also be translated this way: for we are the circumcision who worship God in spirit. Remember Jesus told the woman at the well? He said, the time is coming and it is now here when those who worship will worship in spirit and in truth. For these are the kind of worshipers my Father desires. Do we know what it is to worship the Lord in spirit? It means this: you don't depend on good works or anything you've done. You instead approach God through faith in Christ Jesus, and here's what happens. The result is inward renewal and empowerment by the Spirit of God. We are to be people who live by and serve by the power of the Holy Spirit. So the first mark of a citizen is this: we worship in spirit. The second mark of citizenship is that we glory in Christ Jesus. You know, when Paul talked to, he made that sarcastic remark about look out for the mutilators of the flesh. Look, the only mutilation that saves you and I happened on a cross in Calvary. 2,000 years ago, Jesus was mutilated. He was wounded for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the only boast of the follower of Christ is Christ. It's Jesus. I got nothing to boast in. Just Jesus. Just boast in Jesus. And therefore, Jesus is to receive all of the glory. His name alone is to be magnified. And because our boast only is in Christ, that leads us to the third mark of citizenship, and it's this: we put no confidence in our flesh. No confidence in our flesh. I read about a lady who was having a conversation with her pastor about this matter of faith and works. And she said, I think that getting to heaven is like rowing a boat. One oar is faith and the other oar is works. And if you use both, then you get there. But if you just use one, what's going to happen? You're going to paddle in circles and you're never going to get there. Pastor said, that's a nice illustration, but the only problem is you're not going to heaven in a rowboat. It's not faith and works. There's only one good work that will get the sinner to heaven, and that is the finished work of Christ Jesus on the cross. The Judaizers, they put their trust in the flesh. The true Christian trusts only in Jesus. And we're not to put our trust in the physical or the intellectual or the spiritual or the ceremonial or religious works of the flesh, because they stand in contrast to the work of the Spirit. The true circumcision trusts only in Christ Jesus. Now, when Paul was like giving this example, when he was talking about Jesus in chapter 2, he said, Timothy and Epaphroditus are great examples of this. They're examples of men who are working out their salvation with fear and trembling. They're working out what God has worked in. They're practicing these things. But this time, when Paul needs an example, this time Paul uses himself as an example. And this is a really interesting way for me that Paul is demonstrating all these things that we've just been going over. This is a scripture we're all, if you've been kicking around church for a few years, you are very familiar with what Paul says here, and he uses himself as an example. So now remember this. The marks of citizenship are this, or the obligations and duties of citizenship. Rejoice in the Lord, be aware of some dangers, and know the true marks of citizenship. Now here's Paul. Paul was a person who had different marks on his life. The marks that Paul had were the marks of a dog. Paul had all the marks that the dog would use, that the mutilator of the flesh would use to identify a true follower. He's a total package. Complete package. He had the bite marks. The dogs had sunk their teeth into him, and Paul loved it. He got a thrill out of that dog hanging off his leg, and he's shaking that dog off. Biting him, by the way. Sorry. Paul was infected with that which was most dangerous to humanity, the deadly toxin of religion. That bite had gotten into him, and he was infected. I think it's not a stretch to say that the evil workers perfected their design in Paul. He was the masterpiece, their masterpiece. He was the Mona Lisa of evildoers. Paul was the expression of their perfected work. They mutilated his flesh, and he loved it. He took pride in it. He bragged on his mutilated flesh. The dogs, the evildoers, the mutilators of the flesh, Paul was this. He was their evangelist. He did their bidding, pursued their vision, was on mission with the dogs and the evildoers and the mutilators of the flesh. I mean, he was rabid. Look at Acts chapter 7 and 8. To me, Paul is a rabid dog in Acts chapter 7 and 8, an evil worker, mutilator of the flesh. And it's in this context, pointing to himself as an example, that this description of himself for me really comes off the page. Let's look at it. Check it out. Verse 4. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone else thinks that he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. As to the law, Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. What's he saying? He's saying, I am the total package. Paul had it all. As far as the dogs were concerned, Paul had the best nationality and birth. He had the best relationship to the law, the best relationship to the enemies of Israel. He's born of the purest of Hebrew families. Mutilated on the eighth day. He wasn't a proselyte. He was a Benjamite. Benjamin, along with his brother Joseph, you know, the sons of Jacob, they were the two favorite sons of Jacob, Joseph and Benjamin. And Paul was from Benjamin. His tribe produced the first king in Israel. His tribe was faithful to the house of David. When the 10 northern tribes went off, Paul's house, his tribe, his family was faithful to the house of David. With regards to the law, he's a Pharisee. You know, of the 6,000 Pharisees, I think that it's likely that Paul maybe was a member of the Sanhedrin. If not, he was close to it. Under the tutelage of the most prominent rabbi, Gamaliel. Look, man. If anybody's going to heaven, Paul's going to heaven. If anybody is, he was orthodox of the orthodox. He kept the law and the traditions perfectly. And if that wasn't enough, the perfect specimen must also vehemently oppose the enemies of religion and destroy their lies. And Paul defended his orthodox beliefs by persecuting the followers of that pretender Jesus. I mean, read in Acts. He was there, lending a hand when Stephen was stoned to death. I mean, Paul took upon himself the role of general in the coordinated attack against the church. He could boast in perfect heredity, upbringing, training, and the icing on the cake was his zeal. No one had to light his fire. Persecuting the church for him was the pinnacle of his perfection. Like, That is Paul. Not simply to resist, but to destroy those who would oppose him. Paul was the complete package, a total rabid dog. And then it happened. You know what I'm talking about? Then it happened on the road to Damascus. On the road to Damascus. Jesus came and literally knocked Paul off his high horse. He met Jesus. He met Jesus. And Paul came to faith in Jesus. And then Paul came to this realization that there is nothing greater in this life than knowing Jesus. I was down at a pastor's conference all this week, and it's just kind of cool. I took my 16-year-old Jonah, and we were making our way home. We were flying out of Orange County, and I jumped in the transit van, and I had a driver by the name of Alfonso. It was me and my son Jonah and Alfonso. And he said, "Hey, what are you doing down here?" I said, "Man, I'm down here at a conference." "Oh, really? What kind of conference?" I said, "Oh, it's a conference for pastors and leaders. I'm a pastor." I said, "Really? What do you talk about at those kind of conferences?" I thought, "Wow, Lord, sweet, here we go." And just got to share Jesus with Alfonso. I was telling Kane and Alva, we were just talking about the Lord and sharing Jesus with him. We pulled into the airport, and he goes, "Oh, I went into the wrong entrance. We're in the wrong area of the airport. We got to go back around." And so I thought, okay, Lord, right on. Praise God. Here we go. We'll go back around. Got another 5 minutes with this guy. Come around. And I said at the end, I said, "Alfonso, can I pray with you?" I got to just pray with him. He didn't receive Jesus there, but I'm praying for him. I got out of the car. I said, "Alfonso, knowing Jesus is the greatest thing in my life, man. If I could leave you with one thing, knowing Jesus is the greatest thing in my life." And Paul, in spite of all this stuff that he had, he came to this realization that knowing Jesus is the greatest. There's nothing greater. Look at verse 7. This is where he begins to just cast all this stuff aside. He says, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ." The righteousness from God that depends on faith. Verse 10, "that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead." When Paul speaks of a life, living a life worthy of the gospel and what it looks like to be a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, he just wraps up like this way. He says, "There's nothing better. There's nothing better. I count everything a loss for the sake of knowing Jesus." And I want to just remind you of those things this morning. That knowing Jesus and following him is worth everything. It's worth losing everything because in him we gain everything. And so Paul says this, "Rejoice in the Lord. Learn always to make the arrest. Handcuff whatever's robbing you of your joy. Be aware, there are dangers. There are times when the bite comes. Know the true marks of being a citizen. Worship by the Spirit of God. Glory in Christ Jesus. And put no confidence in the flesh." When he says in chapter 1, verse 27, "Live a life worthy of the gospel," this is it. It's that simple. And I love that. Don't you love that our faith is just simple? To pursue Christ and to know him. You know, Alan Redpath said this. It's a line I love. He said this, "Don't try to be a good Christian. You already have the perfect one living in you. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. Work out what the Spirit is working in. Live a life worthy of the gospel."